Anyone else?
Yajanti Satvika Devan.
Yajanti Satvika Devan.
Yaksha Rakshamsi Rajasaha.
Yaksha Rakshamsi Rajasaha.
Pritam Bhutaganam Chanye.
Pritam Bhutaganam Chanye.
Yajanti Tamasa Janaha.
Yajanti Tamasa Janaha. Anyone else?
Yayanti Satvika Devam.
Yayanti Satvika Devam.
Yaksha Rakshasami Rajasa.
Yaksha Rakshamsi Rajasaha.
Pritam Bhuta Ganamshchanye.
Pritam Bhuta Ganamshchanye.
Yayanti Tamasa Jana.
Yayanti Tamasa Jana.
Thank you. Hare Krishna. Sprechen Sie alle Deutsch?
Nein.
Wie speak?
English.
English.
Also, we came only for
visiting, yes.
Visit.
We are coming from India.
I know. I speak English. So what to do?
English.
Yeah, but I have a German book here.
No, you continue in German, it's fine.
Because
no.
German was still only for visiting.
Yeah, but then you don't understand.
It was fine, you just came for prayer.
No. Or you just say a prayer and you go?
Yeah.
Okay.
The English.
Anyway, just listen to the verse. And then you can go.
Okay.
Should be one in English. Okay, there we go again. 17. No, just leave it for a case. They're going anyway. 17. So the RT is normally at 6 o'clock.
Okay.
So come next time a little earlier.
Okay.
17:04. Please repeat. Jayante.
Jayante.
This is also German.
No problem. You continue, sir.
Verehren. Satvika.
Satvika.
Those in the mode of goodness.
Those in the mode of goodness.
Devan. Demigods.
Demigods.
Yaksha Rakshamsi.
Yaksha Rakshamsi.
Rakshasas, demons.
Demons.
Rajasaha.
Rajasaha.
Kings.
Kings.
Pretam. Ghosts. Bhutaganam. These are also ghosts, so it's a kind of difference.
Cha.
And.
Anye.
Other. Jayante.
Jayante.
Honor. Or the worship. Tamasaha.
Tamasaha.
Those in the mode of ignorance.
Jana. People.
The German, mentioning the Erscheinungsweise der Tugend, verehren die Hauptgötter. Menschen in der Erscheinungsweise der Leidenschaft, verehren der Dämonen. Und Menschen in der Erscheinungsweise der Unwissenheit, verehren Geister und Gespenster. So those in the mode of goodness, they worship the devas, especially in India. In the Western world, they don't. They don't know them. And those in the mode of passion, they worship demons. And those in the mode of ignorance, they worship ghosts. And you can find that in India everywhere. You know, people worshiping ghosts, people worshiping Surya, worshiping Shiva. So like that. But the difference between the worship, do you know from India, one of you three, what is the difference of those going to a temple of a deva or those who are going to a temple of Lord Krishna? Can you tell me what the difference is?
Depends on.
But you have to speak loud.
It depends on your belief. My mom prays Ganpati, Ganesha.
Yes, yes, yes. Okay.
It depends on the belief. If you are from the west part of India, you will believe in Ganesha.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
If you are from our part of India, you will believe in Krishna.
I know.
But for us, everyone is God.
Yeah, yeah. So,
yeah.
So that's the difference between the Hare Krishna temple and normally the Hare Krishnas and the Hindus.
Yeah.
Because it is say Krishna to Bhagavan Swayam. Yeah? So Krishna is the supreme personality of Godhead, and if you read the Srimad Bhagavatam and all the scriptures, then you realize that from Krishna, Mahavishnu comes, you know, Vishnu comes, then Lord Brahma is created, from Lord Brahma, Shiva comes here, Daksha, they're all generated like that. Lakshmi is the consort of Vishnu, of Narayan. So there's a difference between a king and ministers, yeah, like Raja, and then you have the minister of finance, the minister of culture, the minister of foreign affairs, the minister of sport, or the minister of this and that. So you can try to become friends with a minister to get a certain thing. You want something, so you go to a minister. He can give it to you, but he has to ask permission from the king.
Yeah.
So the same with the demigods. You worship the demigods, but how does it sound to you? Om Namo Shivaya. Om. It starts with Om, the percent of God. They can't give you anything without the will of the Supreme Lord. You see, because they're all in their service of Radha and Krishna or Lakshmi Narayan. So that's the difference. So, and also the difference is that in India, most people who worship a demigod, they generally do it for material benefit, for Lakshmi, for getting money, Surya for health, Indra for power, this. But devotees of Krishna, they don't want anything, they want to serve. What can I do? It's called Bhakti Yoga. So in the Bhagavad Gita, there are different kinds of yogas. Hatha Yoga, Jnana Yoga, Astanga Yoga, so many yogas. And then the last one is Bhakti Yoga. So the last, the last verses of the Bhagavad Gita says, just surrender unto me, and I will protect you from all danger, do not fear. So if you know that there's one person completely in charge and the other ones are his servants, because Krishna is just enjoying the spiritual world and he created this material world for us because we somehow or other wanted to be independent of him. So now we can be God ourselves. I my desire, I create my house like this and I'll marry this person because I fancy her. And I want to have this car, so I go like this. So it's everything me. Yeah? Me. In Holland and probably in German, the first words is mama, and papa. Mama means me in Sanskrit, and papa means sinful. Pap means sin. So it's like that. And the mother and father say, oh, they call me. But they say, no, me, everything goes around me. I want milk, I want food, I want shoes, I want this, I want that. Mama, pita. Like that. So if you realize that Krishna is God, then you don't need to worship. Just like if you are friends with the king, you don't need to separately worship the demigods. So the ministers, etc., because you're friends with the king. And if you ask the king, can I, of course, hear, then the minister can say, no, because he didn't ask me, no. God wants like that. So that's the difference. But to worship Ganesh is very nice, because we worship Ganesh to get rid of obstacles for devotion to Krishna. That's why Ganesh is worshipped. Like that, you see? Just like you can worship Hanuman, because Hanuman, is for Sitaram. So like that. But to worship a demigod for just material gain is not. If you come to the temple, he says, oh, please. It's nice if you come to the temple and ask, but better is not to ask, just to give. When you come, in the Bhagavad Gita says, Patram Puspam Phalam Toyam. Bring me with love and devotion a flower, a leaf, you know, some fruit. So next time you come, bring a pineapple or some apples or a bunch of flowers. Just if you see your mother-in-law or friends, you bring her some flowers or some chocolates. Or he doesn't want chocolate, but they like flowers and fruits and vegetables. Like this, it's affection. And he doesn't need it because he's called Atmarama, which means self-satisfied. He doesn't need anything of our money, of our fruit and vegetables. But you know, he gave them in this world. He made trees with fruit for us to eat. But if you offer to him first, then he thinks very nice. Just like when he was very young, right? And you're walking with him and he has maybe a candy in his pocket. I say, Pita, you know, you want a candy? And you look at it and it's maybe dirty and say, oh yes, thank you very much. You know, you don't really need it, but you like that he's offering you something. So Krishna, also, he doesn't want our money, our fruit, our flowers, he wants our devotion. Yeah. But we can show our devotion by giving him something, even if he doesn't need it. So to just to show from the money, which I could have buy some drinks or some whatever, I brought some flowers for Krishna. So he says, oh, very nice, very nice. Like that. So God is just like us. If you, for instance, if you don't like me, right? And every time I see you, I bring you something. Then after a while you think, ah, it's a nice man. Every time he brings me a present, isn't it?
Yeah.
We're like that. So sometimes we meet people, I mean, we don't have a click, but every time they see us, they go, oh, hi, Bo, how are you? You know, they're very happy to see you. And then you start liking that person because they like you. It's common. So we are created in the image of the Lord. We have the, can you move up a little like this, like not sitting with the back to the Prabhupada?
Yes, sir. Yes,
if you move a little like that, move, just you. That's it. Just a little bit. Yeah, thank you. And so it's like that, you know. Okay, so I'm gonna read a little more and then you can go. So do you have a question about this?
No.
Is it clear?
All clear, yeah.
That you wanna go now, please you can go now. Then I'll go to you again.
Yes.
Hare Krishna. So come on Sunday.
Yes.
You come on Sunday regularly?
No, we are not here on Sunday.
Ah, but next Sunday then.
Next Sunday, yeah.
Hare Krishna. Hare
Krishna.
Hare
Krishna.
You can take a flower with you. Okay. Ben, erläuterung. In diesem Vers beschreibt die höchste Persönlichkeit Gottes verschiedene Arten von Verehren in Bezug auf ihre jeweiligen Tätigkeiten. Nach den Anweisungen der Schriften ist allein die höchste Persönlichkeit Gottes der Verehrung würdig. Aber diejenigen, die mit den Unterweisungen der Schriften nicht sehr vertraut sind oder nicht an sie glauben, haben je nach der Erscheinungsweise der materiellen Natur, von denen sie beeinflusst werden, andere Ziele der Verehrung. Hare Krishna. Diejenigen, die sich in Tugend befinden, verehren im Allgemeinen die Hauptgötter. Zu den Hauptgöttern gehören Brahma, Shiva und andere wie Indra, Chandra und der Sonnengott. Es gibt viele verschiedene Hauptgötter. Menschen, die sich in Tugend befinden, verehren aus einem bestimmten Motiv heraus einen bestimmten Hauptgott. You see, so this verse was chosen and then they appeared. So nothing happens by chance. You see, it's everything. So I asked you for a number, it's 17, number 4, and this appeared. So like that. I hope they will learn something. I've learned something. We'll see. Natuur. Er gibt viele verschiedene Halbgötter. Menschen, die sich in Tugenden vielen verehren, aus einem bestimmten Motiv heraus einen bestimmten Halbgott. In ähnlicher Weise verehren diejenigen, die sich in der Erscheinungsweise der Leidenschaft befinden, die Dämonen. Wir erinnern uns in diesem Zusammenhang an einen Mann, der während des Zweiten Weltkrieges in Kalkutta Hitler verehrte, weil er ihm dank des Krieges gelang, durch Geschäfte aus dem Schwarzmarkt sehr viel Reichtum anzuhäufen. Andere in der vermischten Erscheinungsweise der Unwissenheit und Leidenschaft suchen sich einen mächtigen Menschen aus und verehren ihn als Gott. Sie glauben, man konnte als Gott verehren, wie man wollte. Das Ergebnis sei immer dasselbe. And that is the Indian problem. They think it's that's the same end. Doesn't matter if I worship him or her. That's a problem. Wie aus dem vorliegenden Vers klar hervorgeht, sind es die Menschen in der Erscheinungsweise der Leidenschaft, die solche Götter schaffen und verehren. Und diejenigen, die sich in Unwissenheit und Dunkelheit befinden, verehren die Geister von Toten. Manchmal gibt es auch Menschen, die ihre Verehrung in der Grabstätte eines Verstorbenen darbringen. Sexueller Kult ist ebenfalls der Erscheinungsweise der Dunkelheit zuzuordnen. Ebenso gibt es in manchen abgelegenen Dörfern in diesen Menschen die Geister verehren. Wir haben es auch schon gesehen, dass ein Indien manchmal Menschen der niederen Klassen in den Wald gehen, um dort einen Baum zu verehren und ihm Opfer dazu bringen, wenn sie wissen, dass in diesem Baum ein Geist haust. Diese verschiedenen Arten der Verehrung haben in Wirklichkeit nicht zu der Verehrung Gottes zu tun. Die Verehrung Gottes wird von Menschen ausgeführt, die sich auf der transzendentalen Ebene der reinen Tugend befinden. In Srimad Bhagavatam heißt es, Satvam Vishuddham Vasudeva Satitam. Wenn sich ein Mensch auf der Ebene reiner Tugend befindet, verehrt er Vasudeva. Dies bedeutet, dass nur derjenige, die von den materiellen Erscheinungsweisen der Natur völlig frei geworden sind und sich auf der transzendentalen Ebene befinden, die höchste Persönlichkeit Gottes verehren können. Von den Unpersönlichkeitsanhängern heißt es, dass sie sich in der Erscheinungsweise der Tugend befinden und sie verehren fünf Arten von Halbgöttern. Sie verehren die unpersönlichen Form Vishnus in der materiellen Welt, der sogenannten philosophierten Vishnu. Vishnu ist die Erweiterung der höchsten Persönlichkeit Gottes, doch weil die Unpersönlichkeitsanhänger letztlich nicht an die höchste Persönlichkeit Gottes glauben, stellen sie sich vor, die Form Vishnu sei nur ein anderer Aspekt des unpersönlichen Brahman. Ebenso denken sie, Brahma sei die übersinnliche Form der materiellen Erscheinungsweise der Leidenschaft. Auf diese Weise beschreiben sie manchmal fünf Arten von Göttern, die der Verehrung würdig seien. Aber weil sie das unpersönliche Brahman für die eigentliche Wahrheit halten, geben sie letztes Endes alle Objekte der Verehrung auf. Zusammenfassend kann man also sagen, dass man sich von den verschiedenen Einflüssen der Erscheinungsweise der materiellen Natur lauten kann, wenn man sich in die Gemeinschaft von Menschen begibt, die sich auf der transzendentalen Ebene befinden. Ja. So, Srila Prabhupada, very clearly. One second. Very clearly explains this, you see. And that you can see that Prabhupada, you know, he's a realized person, so he can so clearly explain everything in detail about what is right and what is wrong and what is half right, half wrong, a little right or a little wrong or very much wrong or very much right. And that's why, you know, he's just, yeah, he's a self-realized soul, you see. Most of us, Prabhupada disciples, you know, most of us, including gurus, we might have knowledge, realization, we might have some kind of purity, but on the level of Prabhupada, there's only, you know, a few come close, or not even close, but you know, like that. Like even in, like, for instance, in 500 years or 1,000 years, Prabhupada's name will be still there in big, you know, while the next gurus might be, just like in the Bhagavad Gita, you see the line of gurus, but there's only like 21 or so. And there were many more, but these are the most important ones. So in this way, Prabhupada will be there forever and ever, because he's spread it all over the world. And yeah, he performed so many austerities and took up so much headache to spread his movements. And that's why, you know, he's just amazing. Do you have any question, comment? Thank you. Yeah, I like it. No question about the verse, about anything else?
Diese fünf, das in Deutsch versprechen.
Bitte?
Diese fünf Arten von Heilwörtern, was die Mayavai und Unpersonalisten verehren. Warum gerade diese fünf? Gibt es dafür eine Erklärung?
I don't know where it comes from. I don't know where it stems from, where it is. But like, there is Pancha, there's also like they worship, you know, Brahma, Shiva, there's five. I even forgot which five, you know. But here it says Vishnu and another Vishnu. But there's also, but I'm not learned. I'm not into, you know, like that, so I can't. You can ask someone else, but they do it for material, generally to get off, better off materially speaking. Like that, it's not for making spiritual advancement. And as Srila Prabhupada said here, the purport that it generally is, you know, it's an impersonal more than, because they think it's an impersonal form, they don't really believe or whatever. So why worship, you know, why worship something which is impersonal? You know, if it doesn't exist, then why worship something which is, doesn't exist? Or which is energy? How can you worship energy? With some energy? you said, if there's a person, you can worship him with, you can praise the person. Oh, you're so wonderful. Or you can bring him a flower, or you can bring this. If it has no personality, how can you please it in impersonality?
Yes.
You cannot. What they want to do is they want to become like that. They want to merge in that impersonal. That's why it's Mayavadi and it's our power. But, you know, he preached against Mayavadi impersonalism. And most people just see, even if they come to the temple or to the church or to, you know, it's impersonal. They don't really. They just go there. Just like if you go to a shrink, to a psychiatrist, you know, they say, oh, you know, like this, can you help me? Or I'm so sick, or my child is sick, or, you know, it's generally for material benefits. Or I killed someone, please forgive me. Anything else?
Swamiji, is it not a beautiful combination? Bhakti Yoga and Karma Yoga, to put together.
So, what?
Er meint, ob das jetzt eine schöne Kombination ist von Bhakti und Karma Yoga.
David, I don't know. Karma Yoga, karma is you do something to get something.
Yeah.
Yes? But for Bhakti Yoga, you do something without wanting to have something in return, you could say. You understand? So that's why Bhakti is the highest, because nothing is expected of the Lord. He doesn't, He doesn't need to give you something for whatever. And that's why not many people are attracted to it. Because generally they have desires. And they, you know, and they say, oh, yeah, especially, you know, if you worship Shiva, Shiva, he lives, you know, he lives very poorly under a tree. But his worshippers are very rich. And Krishna, he has many thousands of palaces, but his worshippers are generally poor. So he's not attractive to be worshipped, you know, like if you worship Krishna, then, you know. Although, you know, we have millionaires in devotees, so it's not really like that. But generally the case is that often Krishna takes things away from you, like that. But he only doesn't take it away for you if you're going to use it in Krishna's service, then he doesn't. But if he thinks that is a hindrance to your devotional service, he might take your money away or your health away, like that. You know, so your strength away, and like that. So for every soul, every devotee, he has a different medicine. One is very bitter, and one is very sweet, and one is like different. It's, you can't, you know, every devotees that we have, you know, especially when you get old, and I look at my god brothers and god sisters, and some suffer materially very much, some, you know, some health is bad, some like this, some are very strong and they became very weak, and you know, they're shaking, and others are very beautiful, and others very ugly, and some are very healthy, and time, everything is taken away from you in due course of time, you know, till death comes. And but some people are healthy till the moment of death, and they, some people, some devotees pass away in their sleep, some devotees they pass away in an accident, car accident, or so. It's you know, like now there's a war in Ukraine, and there's devotees also there dying, you know, doing food for life, and you think, why is this happening? Krishna has a plan. Sometimes he wants you to come back, and sometimes he has a different. We look at sentimental feelings. Oh, why? But Krishna has a plan. Sometimes devotees go to Mayapur, and then there's always one or two they drown in the Ganga, you know. And then, you know, it's sad, but then, oh, they drown in the Ganga, so they liberate, you know, like that. So it's so different. Like there was this Russian, also I think a Russian who helped with the cinema, ISKCON Cinema, and he was just 21 or so, he drowned in the Ganga 10 years ago or something like that. But this year also an elderly devotee passed away in the Ganga. I was in the, I can't swim, so I went to the Ganga one time just to step in there and to water me. And I went along with some devotees, that was many years ago, I think. 20 years ago or something like that. And then the next day, I really enjoyed it so much, I wanted to go again. So I went there, but somehow or other, I stepped a step further in the river, whatever, and suddenly the water was here, up to here. And I went, hey! and there was just some Indians here who couldn't understand me, of course. Did I say, I'm drowning, I can't swim. So I somehow, hey, sir, Krishna. And then I just, it went back there so I could get out of the water. So it wasn't my time yet, but you had a fright, you know, suddenly death is coming. What are you gonna do when death is coming, you know? When you're in the airplane and suddenly they say, okay, it goes down. You don't know. We all have a different destination. And it can be exciting, you know, it can be a horror. A horror pattern, but it can be also, you know, very exciting. You know how to get out of this body, how to transcend either to the spiritual world or to the next body. Well, because when I was 22, I had an out of body experience. I know I'm not in this body. So it's for me. It is. I don't like to die with pain and disease, etc. because it really hurts me. I really feel pain. I'm not aloof from pain, although I know I'm not this body. But the idea just that I'm dying, say for instance, if I'm lying in a bed and that I'm dying and that my time is coming, then I would just meditate inwards. Where am I? Who am I? And just let it go, whatever. Just recently, a godbrother in Mayapur passed away. He was with oxygen, and some devotees came to see him, and they were talking, and he was talking, and suddenly he went like, and it was gone. So it's different with everyone. So I hope that you all have a nice, a very spiritual Passover without pain. But you know, some devotees are, you know, there is even like nothing on Mataji. And just before she passed away, she could see the spiritual world, or she was knowing what she was supposed to do. And she was telling that, don't you see? Can't you see? Can't you see? And she saw, you know, she saw the spiritual world. And then she was helping with the milk, someone to bring to the gopis or whatever, to Krishna. So like that. Any other question? Hari Bol?
I'd like to ask, mama means mine. Mama means in
ma,
the sense.
Mom. Mom.
Ah, okay. Mm-hmm. And pap means sinful.
What?
Pap.
Papa. Pa. Pa. It's a long A. You have a short A is A, and a long is A. So pap is sinful. That is in Sanskrit. The thing I said about mom and papa is probably nothing to do with it, but I thought it was funny.
And you told us in Ukraine are devotees which are did food for life and they died.
Two of them, they were there's some. They just at the end of, they had were serving food for life, or yeah, I don't know if they were serving, but two died in the something like that. But you know, also devotees, you know, sometimes temples get attacked and devotees, yeah, get it's not that if you're a devotee of Krishna that nothing happens to you, you know, that you don't get an accident, or that you don't get murdered, or you know, shot at, you know, like one that there's a sannyasi who has one leg and. One time in Mayapur, some dacoits, robbers, they came and they tried to steal from the temple and he got hurt and he lost his leg. He's a sannyasa, but it happened like in 1970, in the 70s. So it doesn't mean that nothing comes to you. You know, sometimes a temple also gets robbed, just like recently in, where was it, in the Caribbean. Trinidad, I think, the temple got robbed, and then the devotees, their watch were taken, and their laptop, and their cell phone, and you know, they were blind, etc. Krishna knows it. Nothing happens without his will. So, in generally, if something happens in a temple, that means that something is not going well in the temple. Then you know it's like that. It's not that something happens by chance. Sometimes it's for a good reason. Like in England, there's a temple, and then the kitchen got on fire. Yeah, but then you know, but nothing happened to the deities, fortunately, and then no one got hurt. And then a few years later, you know, they got a huge building, and you know, but they did. So sometimes if something bad happens, it also has a. For the benefit, for a good future, for, to change something like that. Anything else? Okay.
How did you meet Prabhupada?
That question was asked. I met him when I was going with the devotees just like you come from King's Day, you know, to Amsterdam, or so there was an installation of Radhika Uttananda in a manor, so we went there with the devotees. But Prabhupada was in Europe, all devotees from Sweden, Germany, England. You know, that's why you see many pictures of me together with Satchinanda Swami is in it, or his brother. And you know, devotees from those times, they were from Germany or from England, or from, they all come to London, Matriyatra, or where German Prabhupada is in Germany, and they come from, or from France, then we go there. And this way, I just put on Facebook, I put a picture of the temple in France, and there's devotees there, you know, from France, from Germany, from Sweden, so like that. So we went to Sweden to see Prabhupada, we went to England to see Prabhupada, we went to France to see Prabhupada, we went to Germany to see Prabhupada. That's the way we just met him. But I didn't have a relationship with him, I just saw him. Because at that time there were thousands of disciples, you know. When you joined in the 65 up till 1970, you can just go in his room and say, well, you know, and it's very intimate and he knows you personally. But in 72, 73, there were thousands of disciples, you know, like that. It's just like that, you know. If you see a picture of you, you can say, okay, if there's somebody else next to you, then you just happen to be there. Yeah, you like that. So the next, oh, what did he say to you? He didn't say to me. I mean, just happened to be there. It's like that. Very good fortune. And also, at that time, because I didn't join Prabhupada, I joined the Hare Krishna movement.
Oh.
I've never seen him. I just liked the chanting, I liked the philosophy, I liked the prasadam. And his picture was there in the book, but so what? Didn't mean anything to me. I did. So those who joined in 1965, they joined him.
Yes.
ISKCON didn't exist. They joined him, Swamiji. They went to see him. I didn't go to see him. I went to see to the temple. I went to see, you know, like that.
Mm-hmm.
So that's why my relationship is completely different, although I joined a few years later, because I didn't have that relationship with him. But, you know, and then only later I realized what he had, you know, that he's my greatest well-wisher. Before that, no, I just, oh, that's a guru, Allah.
Mm-hmm.
But then I realized, and then especially I didn't know that he had suffered heart attacks on the boat, that his Bhagavad Gita manuscript was stolen, with his type particles stolen. I didn't know anything about that. You know, I just saw him, and there he was, there he went, he gave class, and he looked very strict, and sometimes he was smiling, but I hardly could understand him because I'm Dutch, and he speaks Indian English with an Indian accent, and then all these Sanskrit terms, Maya, blah, blah, blah. You know, man, I'm tired. Because when we're traveling, you have to find a place, you know, where permanent of the devotees, and you sleep in the temple room, in the hallway, in the toilet, in the bathroom, you sleep anywhere. And so we're always tired, you know, so often. One time I was on Hari on the book distribution in Copenhagen, because he went to Stockholm, so we went from Holland, we went to Germany, we did in Hamburg, Sankitan, then we went to Denmark, then to Oslo, then to Stockholm. Anyway, so I was in Copenhagen, Sweden, then to Sweden, and then he gave a class, a talk at the University of Uppsala, in the evening. So we went there, and I was very tired after the day of Sankitan. And so it was like in a hall, and then you have to, like in a theater, you have to, the balcony, you know, like this.
Mm-hmm.
So I went there to take a rest, and I told one of my godbrothers, I'm going to have a nap, wake me up when Prabhupada comes. So I sleep, and I woke up when Prabhupada said, at the end of the class, thank you very much.
Oh.
So like that. So there are many of my godbrothers, called sisters, who have much association with Prabhupada. But where are they? You know, they left him.
Oh.
You know, they, whatever, you know. But You know, and there's many who never had association with him, maybe have not even seen him, they're still here. So it is, you know, yeah, it's like that, it's different.
Yeah, maybe as when they are following him and then he left, then they have nothing to follow. Yeah. And you joined as a movement, and the movement is still there. Mm-hmm. The spirit of Prabhupada is there.
Yeah, it's also some people, because the movement did change with the new gurus, and then, you know, at that time, when it's Sona Acharya days, then even here, then most Prabhupada disciples were like, you know, all the disciples were brahmacharis, and most Prabhupada disciples were married at that time, and they were all in Maya, you know, and only a few were kept the position, most of them, and they went to Sweden or they went away, you know, to Germany. Depends on which zone you were. But it's, and then because of that, many of my, also I left in 85 because of that, because of the movement wasn't the same as it was before. So then things have changed again back, you know, still not the same, but it's like that. So many left and just kept Prabhupada in their heart and continued to service, but at home. Mm-hmm. But others, they forgot about it. Just like the story of Dhruva Maharaj, Narada Muni, Prahlad Maharaj. So the mother of Prahlad Maharaj was pregnant with Prahlad. So there was a fight between the demigods and the demons. And the demigods won, and they kidnapped, they took the wife of Hiranyakashipu, and because she was pregnant, she wanted to kill the child in the womb because it was the son of Hiranyakashipu. So they wanted to have another demon born. But then Narada Muni appeared, said, no, I'll take care of it. So he took to his ashram the pregnant mother, and then he was preaching to her. And later, Prahlad says, my mother forgot all about you, but I not in a womb. So you see, so she forgot. She heard so many instructions of who? Of Narada Muni. So many God brothers, God sisters heard so many instructions of Prabhupada, but in due course of time, they forgot. They got, you know, they left outside and they got a job and they got children and they forgot about the teachings and they went on with their life. Mm. So it's like that, but for the others, who have absorbed, who have heard, have the heard in ears, and that it has landed here. It's just like Jesus gave the example of you throw seeds. They throw seeds on the earth. Some grow like this, but there are stones underneath, and they go, others fall like this. Others throw on good earth, and it grows and grows and grows and grows. So it is how much Krishna consciousness absorbed inside here. You know, if you keep chanting, if you keep hearing like that. Mm. Okay? Thank you very much. Sri Prabhupada, by whose mercy we've all gathered here together and able to hear this absolute truth of this Supreme Personality of Buddha. Ki jai!
Jai!
Hare Prabhu ki jai!
Gaura Bhakta Vrinda ki jai!
Nongalati ki jai! Jayante Satvika Devam.